BlackTV247 News for the latest information relating to the Black experience. I'm Erin Elkins, and here are today's headlines. Our top story: outrage continues to build after video that shows a Seattle police officer punching a 17-year-old girl went viral on the internet. The video shows Officer Ian P. Walsh trying to arrest 19-year-old Marilyn Levias. The two were already struggling when Levias's friend, a 17-year-old, pushed the officer. His response was quick and violent. Watch again in slow motion as the police officer winds up and punches the teenage girl directly in the face, a move many are saying crossed the line.
The provocation of the 17-year-old may have presented a confrontation situation, but the use of violence in the form of a full-blown fist to the face was wrong.
Official guidelines do allow for a punch to constrain an unruly person, but the Seattle PD even admits this may have gone too far.
We do have some concerns about the tactics that the officer used and he employed at the time. Force never looks good. It's never pretty. So you have to obviously take into context everything that occurred.
Both women were taken into custody. The officer in question has been transferred while the investigation takes place. Recently released court records show Levias has been arrested for assaulting a police officer before. In other headlines, after a face-to-face meeting with President Barack Obama, BP has agreed to put $20 billion into an independently managed account to cover economic damages related to the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. Obama announced the agreement after meeting with top BP executives at the White House to discuss the spill, which has become the worst environmental disaster in U.S. history.
This $20 billion will provide substantial assurance the claims people and businesses have will be honored. It's also important to emphasize this is not a cap. The people of the Gulf have my commitment that BP will meet its obligations to them.
But critics say talk is cheap. Nevertheless, it continued with Carl Enrique Svanberg, the chairman of BP, who apologized after the meeting, saying BP will live up to its end of the bargain.
He's frustrated because he cares about the small people, and we care about the small people.
BP also agreed to set aside $100 million to compensate oil workers idled by the government-imposed moratorium on deep-water drilling. One Gulf Coast resident summed up the political back and forth by simply saying, "Prove it," a sentiment that's becoming all too familiar as the Gulf oil crisis sits on day 59. And those are our headlines. And now it's time for our trek across the nation. First stop, Indiana. A female inmate at the county jail blames nurses for these painful blisters covering her entire body. 24-year-old Lakia Brown says nurses continued giving her the wrong seizure medicine and at three times the normal dosage. After weeks of complaining, authorities took Brown to the hospital, but by then her eyes were swollen shut and she could barely breathe. Doctors think Brown has Stevenson-John syndrome, a potentially deadly skin disease. Bartlett, Tennessee, where the case of a man accused of pulling a gun on his son's baseball coach is headed to a grand jury. Nicholas Williams was released on $20,000 bond after investigators say the 29-year-old pulled a loaded pistol on his son's baseball coach. According to investigators, Joseph Powell asked Williams not to use profanity in front of the kids, prompting Williams to pull his gun. Powell grabbed Williams, took him to the ground, and held him until help arrived. South Carolina. Could it be that a man behind Gospel and Soul helped Alvin Green, a man with no job, no campaign, and a pending felony, become South Carolina's Democratic nominee for Senate? Well, that's the reason Gail Westerfield is giving. The registered Democrat says she's ashamed because she voted for Green because his name sounded like the singer Al Green. Since Green's victory, the party has called for him to withdraw. He refuses, leaving Westerfield humiliated that she had something to do with it all. And that's our trek across the nation. And now on the international front. Thousands of fans are at the FIFA World Cup in South Africa waiting for their favorite team to score. Others are looking to score themselves with prostitutes who have traveled from all over the world looking to do business with nearly 450,000 mostly male fans. According to estimates, 40,000 sex workers are on round-the-clock duty for post-game activities. Stop 2010 Human Trafficking, a project organized by a nonprofit Christian alliance in South Africa, puts the numbers at as many as 100,000. Human trafficking is the fastest-growing criminal industry in the world. The total annual revenue for trafficking humans is estimated to be between $5 billion and $9 billion U.S. dollars. Part of the danger is that more than 1 in 10 South Africans live with HIV. Among prostitutes, that rate reaches 1 in 4. Kinshasa, a United Nations official in Congo, says the first group of UN peacekeepers scheduled to withdraw from the chaotic Central African country is leaving. Peacekeeping mission spokesman Alain Lakota says 230 peacekeepers from Senegal had left or are scheduled to leave by the end of the week. The UN agreed to a request from Congolese President Joseph Kabila to send home 2,000 peacekeepers before June 30th, the date that marks the 50th anniversary of Congo's independence from Belgium. The UN mission will continue until mid-2011 with some 21,000 military personnel, observers, and police. And that's a look on the international front. And now, sports and entertainment. This month's BET Awards will be a royal affair. Prince is getting a lifetime achievement honor. The 51-year-old superstar joins the likes of James Brown, Whitney Houston, Diana Ross, and Al Green in being honored by the BET Awards, which will celebrate its 10th year anniversary in Los Angeles on June 27th. BET says the Prince tribute will stand out. And as one BET insider puts it, Prince is dynamic, Prince is genius, Prince is music. The BET show will be hosted by Queen Latifah. Well, Joe Jackson is at it again. The much-maligned patriarch of the first family of pop is now claiming that his estranged wife Catherine is at fault for their son's untimely death. Here's what some of the elder Jackson had to say.
As a mother, you know, mother always the one the sons looks up to. I wanted her to step in and go in and live with Mike a bit and keep him cheered up because, you know, if a mother's around you, the son, I would think, would feel better. But she didn't want to do that because she was afraid that she was invading his privacy. She didn't want to invade him, his privacy. And so I thought, we argued about that several times, and she says, and I think I mentioned telling her, I said, Catherine, if you don't go and see him, be with him a while, I said, he ain't gonna be with us too long, because I thought he was looking kind of funny, frail a little bit.
According to Joe, the King of Pop was, quote, a mama's boy who would always listen to his mother. He also adds that he's incensed with Catherine and that if she'd only listened to him, Michael would be here today. As previously reported, Michael left his three children $33 million each and his mother 40% of his estate. His father was shut out of the will completely. And finally, this Game 6 throwdown by Lakers guard Shannon Brown is being called the greatest playoff dunk of all time. Take a look.
Not the case with Kendrick Perkins, sprained knee. Shannon Brown! Wow! We've seen him at times with some of the most explosive dunks in the league.
You think? I mean, it's good, but the greatest of all time? You decide. As for us, we'll watch it one more time in super slow-mo as we wrap sports and entertainment. And now, on this day in Black history, security guard Frank Wills removed duct tape from a door lock of an office building he was patrolling, a gesture that triggered events which exposed the greatest scandal in American political history, Watergate. Wills became a hero, even portraying himself in the Oscar-winning movie All the President's Men. But he'd never recover from his 15 minutes, eventually dying destitute and alone. Nevertheless, his actions led to the fall of an American president, and it all began on this day in 1972. Well, that's it for us here at Black TV 24/7 News. For more information on the stories covered during this newscast, please visit us at BlackTV247News.com and click on the story links. Until tomorrow, I'm Erin Elkins. Have a scandal-free day. And remember, you can catch us online 24/7.